I'm Stephen Scheuer, welcoming you to another in our series of oral histories in which we are fortunate indeed to be able to interview those persons who have helped shape the style and substance of television and our major media today. This is a special episode of Television in America, an autobiography, because we have two distinguished guests, Morley Safer and Richard Hottelet. Both explore a major common aspect of their legendary careers, the war correspondent. The war spanned two eras, World War II and Vietnam. We begin with Morley Safer of 60 Minutes, whose early Vietnam reporting for CBS News launched his career while helping to articulate and define a war which bitterly divided America. Here is his report on a village called Cam Ne, which caught the attention of viewers and especially President Lyndon Baines Johnson.
This is what the war in Vietnam is all about. The old and the very young. The Marines have burned this old couple's cottage because fire was coming from here. And now when you walk into the village, you see no young people at all.
Been in action like this before, Marine?
No, I haven't. Not like this, I haven't.
Did you set fire to these houses here?
No, we were just off to the left of it when it was burning.
Were you getting fire from them?
Somewhat, not too much. Just a little sniper fire.
If there were Viet Cong in the hamlets, they were long gone. Alerted by the roar of the amphibious tractors and the heavy barrage of rocket fire laid down before the troops moved in. The women and the old men who remained will never forget that August afternoon.
Our guest today has been a CBS News correspondent since April 1964, based in the London Bureau. He opened its Saigon Bureau in 1965, served two tours in Vietnam, and won honors and critical acclaim for his reporting, such as the piece we've just seen. Ever since 1970, he has been a co-editor of CBS News' 60 Minutes, being one of the principal lapidaries of what has been called the Tiffany Network. He owns two of the most respected words in broadcast journalism, Morley Safer. Welcome, Morley.
Lapidary indeed.
Morley, the piece we just saw ran on CBS News, I believe, in August of 65, and unquestionably helped change the minds of many Americans who were being told by President Lyndon Johnson, in essence, that in Vietnam we were involved in a combat mission paralleling the so-called good fight of World War II against communist aggression and so forth. Tell us, please, how this story came about.
I was in our so-called Da Nang Bureau, which was a tiny little kind of, it was actually an ex-brothel in Da Nang that was became known as the press camp. And it was run by the Marines. And what we did when we would do our week or so up in Da Nang, each of us who was were in the Bureau, and we weren't many at that point, we'd spend a week up there covering what the Marines were doing in the so-called First Corps, as the military called it, I Corps of Vietnam. And it was fairly routine to go out and visit Marine units at base camps in an afternoon to find out what they were doing, what operations they had planned, trying to make arrangements to go along if they looked interesting. It was a pretty quiet time, and I went to this particular unit and said they were going on an amphibious assault that would search and destroy operation the next day. Please come. I came. And I asked a young captain what exactly we were doing. And he said, well, we're going in, we're going to punish a village. And I'd never heard that before, ever. In covering, I don't know, half a dozen wars up to that point, I had never, I've heard anger by French officers in Algeria, and the same thing in Israeli officers, but I've never heard that phrase before, punish a village. And it was said just before we landed, or we landed on semi-dry land, and the Marines went on, I was going to say ashore, because but it was merely going from wet paddy to drier land, in a single line. And we approached this group of hamlets. Kamnay is not a village, it's a collection of hamlets. And if you look at the military maps at the time, they were called Kamnay 1, Kamnay 2, Kamnay 3, and each little grouping of huts was a hamlet. There was no fire coming at all from towards the unit that I was with until I did hear to my right some rifle fire, and one of the Marines went down, hit in the backside. And that, I believe to this day, was friendly fire. Both from where he was hit and the fact that it had not been preceded by anything. The Marines had preceded it with rocket fire, with a very heavy barrage of rocket fire into this hamlet. So the punishment had already begun before we arrived. The young soldier I spoke to briefly, who was taking cover, said there was somewhat sniper fire. I can't recall. So I recall various small arms fire, but in the confusion of war or of a fire of battle, you never know where that fire is coming from. It wasn't massive fire the way it can be in an ambush or something like that. It was sporadic fire. In any case, there was no evidence of any Viet Cong. There were a couple of things that happened along the way. The cameraman I was working with, a man named Hatukan, a Vietnamese cameraman, and I proceeded through the hamlet. This was after the scenes we saw, and the piece, as broadcast as you know, was much longer piece. And the Marines were using flamethrowers as well as cigarette lighters and anything that would create fire to burn this, to further punish this hamlet. They were about to let go with a flamethrower at a particular hamlet. We, Khan and I, heard voices coming, and he jumped up and stopped the Marine from firing. By the way, he was the only Vietnamese-speaking person on the operation, was the CBS cameraman. The Marines did not have anyone who spoke Vietnamese, and including not an Arvin, a South Vietnamese Army interpreter, no one. Khan went into this hooch, as the Marines call it, moved a little stove, and then up came this down, and out came this family with holding a baby. And the Marines used that as an example that this was an armed Viet Cong defensive position, because people had shelters under the houses. There wasn't a home outside of Saigon that didn't have some kind of place to take shelter from whoever. In any case, that was quite a dramatic moment, and quite a for all of us, including the Marines, by the way. The young lieutenant was angry and embarrassed and scared and shocked about what he'd almost done, what he'd almost ordered to happen. What happened at Kamnay, of course, it wasn't the only time a Kamnay happened. It was the first time that reporters were there. First time that certainly the television was present. And again, the utter confusion of any military operation. I've forgotten exactly what I said at the end of the piece, but I tried to give the number of houses burned. And I honestly don't remember. I said 80 or 100 or so. The fact was it was many more. It was about double that or more. Because Charlie Moore, the New York Times correspondent, the late Charles Moore, was in a helicopter during this operation. And he saw what was going on the ground and saw the smoke coming up. And I think that in the next day's time, Charlie estimated somewhere between 125 and 200. My numbers may be slightly off here. But it was much bigger. You know, the reporter on the ground, like the soldier on the ground's view of war is that much. It's very, very narrow field of vision that one has. And that's why one must be very careful when you're reporting it, especially reporting it in the heat of the moment. Because what you're seeing is the whole war. That's it. And that is a fairly blinkered view. But it was interesting, and I'm glad that Charlie was up in that helicopter having this broad view, because as it turned out, when the Marines denied it, virtually anything had happened, and perhaps one or two houses had been burned by accident.
Who was it that said we're going to punish them today? Whose quote was that?
It was a young captain. I mean, he didn't say it with particular passion. He said as if these are our orders to punish this village. It wasn't said with anger or venom or anything.
How long, Morley, after you shot the piece and edited it somewhat?
We didn't edit it.
You didn't edit it?
We didn't have the facility.
You edited it in the camera, right?
Well, it was edited back in New York. Actually, I think it was edited in California. I mean, this was the immediacy of that time was to take that film, get it back to Saigon, put it on an airplane, send it to either New York or California, where it would have to be processed, and then edited and broadcast. So it was at least 24 hours before it was on the
air. Were there any questions back to you about the piece? Was there any concern at CBS News? Was there any timorousness?
Let me just back up slightly. What happened was I sent the film to Saigon. Yeah. From Saigon, it was shipped on to the States. But this story was really, I thought, very important, and I sent a cable to the Evening News saying, in effect, reporting the story in words only, which was read on the air that night as a straight piece to camera. I think Harry Reisner was doing the news that night. And so first there was my report, my eyewitness report, if you like, which gave the Pentagon and the Marines a moment of what's going on here, and they denied, and then the next night the film turned up to, I mean, this wasn't planned, this was an important story which I filed, and then the film turned up. So the denials were included in
in that first report, in the Evening News.
And then the other shoe dropped, in effect.
Today's operation is the frustration of Vietnam in miniature. There is little doubt that American firepower can win a military victory here. But to a Vietnamese peasant whose home means a lifetime of backbreaking labor, it will take more than presidential promises to convince him that we are on his side.
Morley Safer, CBS News, near the village of Kamni.
Morley, how did the White House react, especially the man in the Oval Office?
Well, he was very angry. I wasn't there. I only got some backlashes later on in Vietnam. And that he called Frank Stanton, who was the president of CBS at that time. And I don't believe Dr. Stanton had actually seen the broadcast that night. And he called Dr. Stanton and said, "Frank, you just shat on the American flag." It was a very Johnsonian response, as pithy and in his own way charming as a thing a president could say. But that was the immediate reaction by the White House. There was some investigation of who the hell Morley Safer was. Charged with that chore was the saintly Bill Moyers. And there was some suggestion that I was communist, and I believe Moyers corrected him. This is Moyers' version. He said, no, he's a Canadian. The president's reaction was, no Dutch difference, or something like that.
They say you were a KGB agent or something?
Something, you know, it was just. More significant to me in Vietnam at the time was the reaction by the Pentagon and by the Marine Corps, however.
Tell us about that, the brass first, and then those with whom you were in combat.
Well, you had a couple of reactions. You had the reactions of the Military Assistance Command, MACV as it was called, and that was just General Westmoreland's.
Another fan of CBS. Office.
The Marines up there were under his command. And then you had the Pentagon back in Washington. So everybody was reacting. Westmoreland was chewing out the Marines on the one hand. The Pentagon was chewing out Westmoreland, but saying, why are you giving these guys access? The State Department, not the State Department, I shouldn't say the State Department, certain members of the State Department accused me of creating that whole thing. That was a concoction. This was a Marine training exercise in an old burned out village, and
on the back
and I was so. Directing, you know, bring in the Marines, bring in the peasants, bring in the flamethrowers. The Marines were, there's only one word for it, were pissed. They were very, very angry with me. And to the extent that there were real threats. I mean, you're talking about a lot of guys with a lot of heavy weapons. And I had left Da Nang and was back in Saigon. And when the word came back that if I ever showed my face in Da Nang again, it would be
friendly fire.
And one does what, you know, the impetuousness of youth. I said to Hattigan, let's go back to Da Nang. What can happen? So we did. We did. And I was sent to Coventry, as they say in Britain.
Did you ever go out with this particular unit again on any other operation?
I don't think with that unit, but I went out on marine operations lots of times after that. I was given the cold shoulder and the silent treatment, and you know, a few drunks got a little bit more stroppy than that. But So the only people who would talk to me at Da Nang were the Air Force guys who didn't who were also not on the friendliest of terms with Marines. So I had my own sources.
Why weren't the Air Force guys?
Well, it's just I'm
just in the service rivalry.
Just the in the service rivalry, which which is intense, especially if the Marines are involved, because the Marines have always been considered, have always considered themselves to be the bravest, the toughest, and indeed they have been, but also the least well served by the Pentagon, for example. I mean, that was have the used to have the oldest equipment. They were the last to get the new stuff, that kind of thing. So there was a certain inter-service rivalry going on, no question. And the Marines didn't much like the Air Force because they had their own flyers and they preferred.
Like World War II, the grunts Marines. And the...
Yeah.
Wasn't there, the Morley, some Marines who thanked you for doing that piece privately?
Yes. Well, it was interesting. That was quite interesting because after the event, well after it, I mean, a week or 10 days, I started to get letters and notes dropped, some anonymous, some just asking, please do not identify, saying it's time someone pulled the chain on us because this is happening all the time. You know, this was a story I didn't report, obviously, because there was no way of reporting without it seeming to be self-serving, and certainly I had to protect the people who were talking to me. I mean, this wasn't unique in terms of officers during the war giving reporters either encouragement or indeed stories, because they felt that this war or the way this war was being fought was not serving the best interests of their country.
What did you learn of Mr. Paley's reaction? Did it give him a stomach ache, your reporting?
I don't know. But the joy of working for CBS News, particularly in those years, was the joy of giving the boss a stomach ache and not hearing about it.
That's terrific.
That was a very special.
Absolutely.
This was a very special company in the history of the fun and games of television and television news, particularly in television news.
We're going to take a look now at a compilation, I suppose, Morley Safer's Vietnam, a personal report, probably included many of the stories that you filed.
That came about when I was getting a little bit shell-shocked or something. And I told Salam, I want to get out. Dick Salam was then president. And I said, yes. I want out of here. I got to get out. Maybe I'll come back, but he said, no, stay another month or so, and that's the last time. Of course, I went back twice, and do an hour on your reflections on Vietnam.
Tell them to keep moving north.
There's a terrible familiarity about it, about being an occupying power. The look of it conjures up an image a generation of Americans was taught to reject. It should, it seems to me, be our pleasure and duty to make these people free, and let them deal with their own domestic questions in their own way. And so I am an anti-imperialist. I am opposed to having the eagle put its talons on any other land. The words are Mark Twain's about another war.
What a piece of work. What does that stir up in your memories? You're back there then?
Oh, really, yeah. I mean, it's all kinds of memories. I mean, some wonderful memories and, you know, absent friends, all that. When you see it, I can also smell it. and it really sounds so banal to say, it's as if yesterday. It really, really is. I haven't seen that for a long time. So.
Morley once said that Vietnam was television's a television war. How do you compare the coverage and the access for journalists, World War II and Vietnam?
Well, I didn't cover World War II, obviously, but lots of friends did. And the essential difference, World War II was war with censorship. I mean, even more interesting is, say, take World War II, Vietnam, and the Gulf War, any of the subsequent excursions since Vietnam. World War II had censorship. Vietnam had no censorship. World War II, while it did have access, it was access, A, within the censorship, and B, within it being a kind of frontal war, reporters did not get to the front. They tended to be in the rear, not for wanting to try to get to the front, as many did, as Ernie Pyle did, as Cronkite did, as many did. But it was a much more control, really. Vietnam, we had access to everything. I mean, you wanted to get a helicopter ride somewhere, you went out to Tunsinat Air Base, and you found a chopper that was going where you were going. It was as simple as that. And there was virtually nowhere you couldn't go. Some places you had to be a little more manipulative to get to Consin Island, which was this big secret South Vietnamese, whatever you call it, concentration camp. And a few other places that were a little bit difficult, but virtually nowhere you couldn't get to. We go to the next phase, step to Grenada, Panama, the Gulf War. There was virtually no place you could get to. A new generation of Army press and information officers had been trained, very well trained, to keep the press out. The lessons of Vietnam, they are still teaching the lessons of Vietnam to information officers at the War College, or within the individual services. And that was never again will we give the kind of access we had, because it was, who lost Vietnam? Well, among the people who lost Vietnam was the media, as the press came to be known.
In an earlier interview at the time you published your book, Flashback on Returning to Vietnam, you said, quote, "All Americans should go to Vietnam. I think it's a very interesting history lesson. I think the word is learned too late." And you obviously still feel strongly that way.
Yes, and I'll tell you, one of the reasons I think Americans should go to Vietnam to make a really quite interesting discovery about the Vietnamese, and here are two people so much alike. The Vietnamese, even under the worst regimes that they had, and under the heel of quite a repressive regime, had huge admiration for Americans. including, as you know, Ho Chi Minh himself. And, you know, people say, oh, because of their resourcefulness and wealth. I think the thing that the Vietnamese admire most about Americans is their entrepreneurship. Is the mom-and-pop grocery store that can end up becoming a supermarket chain, that idea. And to that extent, we are the same people.
Two cultures as one. Two guests reporting on a single theme. World War II is the beat of Richard C. Hottelet, one of the Murrow boys, who worked under Edward R. Murrow from 1938 to 1946, then continued a four-decade career at CBS News. Murrow, said Hottelet, showed us that a word is worth a thousand pictures. Hottelet's words covered the D-Day invasion and overall the difference between reporting World War II and Morley Safer's time in Vietnam. We begin with Richard Hottelet discussing his student days in Berlin.
I arrived in Berlin actually just after Mussolini had been to Berlin, and the Goebbels had set up a mise-en-scène with a great official welcome, pillars with the gold Nazi eagle and hatching a swastika. And, in any case, somebody said, well, look, there are some American folks in town who might need somebody. My German was improving by that time. And I went to the United Press and asked if they had a job. And they said, well, no, but I could stay in touch and maybe give them some, be their university correspondent. I was still looking around in the university. And so I had established a contact with the United Press. And in the at the beginning of 1938, an interesting thing happened. Hitler revamped the high command. He was aiming for military power in Europe.
When did this become clear to you that there would be a war and the Germans would attack Poland or whatever?
Early in 1938, it was quite clear.
It was clear.
Because they had the Anschluss in March of 38, and he was beginning to sort of pump up a propaganda war against the
Poles.
Where
most of Europe accepted the takeover of Austria.
That's right. And actually, that was the first time I saw Hitler up close. Our boss, Fred Erksner, a superb journalist, said, well, now, you know, there's not really much for you to do around here. Go over to Tempelhof Airport and see Hitler coming back from Vienna.
In triumph.
In those days, they still hadn't got their triumphs quite orchestrated. They did much better jobs. I mean, this wasn't a big Nazi propaganda, Nazi party congress. He arrived at Tempelhof, which was a dinky little airport, in a Junkers three-motored plane.
That was changed by the Berlin airlift.
Changed by the Berlin airlift. Well, it was changed subsequently, in any case, by the field marshal who built a huge sort of semicircle there for arrivals and departures. But this was a small airport, and they got off the plane, and there was a small group of officials to meet him, and among them was Goebbels. And Goebbels walked up to him and said, "My Führer, I am the interpreter here. I'm the spokesman of the German people. Welcome you back from this, your great feat in Vienna." And I was as close or closer to Hitler than I am to you here. And I wondered what this man was. And I'd heard all this garbage about his magnetic glance and his steely blue eyes and this absolutely overwhelming optical power. And I looked in the eyes, and they didn't look strange or different or superior in any way. And he sort of mumbled something to Goebbels, and they went off. So this was Hitler as a human being. In his own way, but I stayed a bit. It became clear after that that they were whooping up for something. The next step was, of course, Czechoslovakia.
What was the response, and how were those dispatches of yours played out in the American press, in CBS radio or wherever else they were carried?
Well,
at the
CBS
time
was hardly radio, but in those days they just took the AP and the UP,
right,
and read the copy. But there was considerable interest. Of course, in November of 1938, the anti-Semitism, which was one of the foundations, one of the basics of the Nazi regime, exploded in the so-called Kristallnacht, the Kristallnacht, when after the assassination of a German diplomat in Paris by a Jewish boy, a Polish Jewish boy, they trashed the economic foundation of the Jewish community, what was left of it in Germany.
It started in Munich, or where did it take place?
I saw it in Berlin.
In Berlin.
It started with, simultaneously all over the place, in Munich too. But what had set this boy to kill the German diplomat was the expulsion in September of Polish Jews who had lived in Germany. And what triggered that was the Poles, which was a sort of fairly right-wing government at the time, saying that they would not recognize the Polish citizenship of Polish Jews living outside Poland. And Hitler at once responded by loading them aboard trains and sending them into Poland. And one of the stories I covered was getting aboard one of these trains with these Polish deportees and following them across, at first into no man's land because they were expelled from Germany, but they were not admitted into Poland. And for a while they stayed in this belt across the border. And
The facilities must have been appalling.
Were primitive, to put it mildly. And that was the first time I was arrested, coming back and having telephoned my piece from the Germans to the railroad station at Neubenchen on the border there. A man came up.
You would have telephoned it back to the UP
office. To the UP in Berlin, yeah. A man came up and said, "Well, who are you?" And I said, "I'm a reporter. And what did you do? Where did you send your, where did you deposit, or where did you mail your story?" I said, "Didn't mail my story. My story is in New York already. It went by phone to the Berlin office, and they at once teletyped it to New York." And in any case, she said, "Well, come with me." And I was arrested there, held for 24 hours. Before they saw that it was pointless to keep me, and I was released. But that was a sort of an exclamation mark, a political exclamation mark on the road from the Anschluss to the Sudetenland, and then on to the preparations for the march in Poland. Hitler was showing his teeth, and the story became, of course, more and more dramatic after that.
Some years later, when you were working with Howard K. Smith in the Berlin office, the Gestapo came and ransacked the place and detained Howard for some hours. And then you were actually arrested, as I understand it, and spent almost 4 months in prison.
Yeah, that was in 1941. That was
41,
in March of 1941.
Share with us what it felt like to be in prison in Germany in 1941. I can't imagine.
The knock at the door, the classic knock at the door at 2 o'clock in the morning, and two men.
They picked you up at your home.
Picked me up at our house. I shared a flat with an apartment with Joe Grigg, who was also working at the UP, and just hauled me off and said, "Nothing." No, I said, "Well, what are you doing this for?" No answer. And I went through the wheels of being fingerprinted and mug-shotted at the Alexanderplatz prison, which was the great prison in central Berlin, and waited there to hear what the score was. And I don't know, after many hours, they said, "Well, we're holding you for suspicion of espionage." And the reason they held me was that that picked me up in the first place was that a German newspaper man had been arrested in New York, really being caught with the goods of espionage.
He really was a spy,
and I was going to be the counterpoint. I was going to be the hostage for the trade-off, and so I. But they went through the act and interrogation. I was never beaten or anything, but. They were terribly afraid I'd commit suicide, so the lights were on in my little cell all night. When you're tired enough, you don't mind light burning overhead.
Did they give you things to read? Did they allow you to have outside contact?
I was allowed to see an American consular official once or twice, who brought me cigarettes. In those days, I smoked. And I was allowed to see the, I think the photo.
What did they say about when they'd get you out of jail?
Oh, they didn't say anything at all because they didn't know.
Were they trying?
They didn't know. Yes, of course they were trying. But of course, one part of the psychological preparation for the police and the secret police in those days was nobody's worried about you. They've got other things to do. You're here, and we're going to deal with you. And don't think that anybody's going to help you get out. So just tell the truth. And so they interrogated me about all kinds of things, including the arrest of some British Secret Service agents who had been lured across the border from the Netherlands. And they asked me about the bomb plot that blew up the Bürgerbräu beer hall in Munich just a matter of hours after Hitler had made a speech there on the anniversary of his putsch in November of 1923. In other words, they were fishing around for anything at all. And needless to say, I wasn't much use. But I was held anyway and kept there for maybe several weeks and then transferred to Moabit, another prison in West Berlin, and told I was going to be tried in the People's Court. Well, that was rather disturbing because the People's Court was Hitler's Nazi court for the elimination of people he didn't like, a legal murder institution. And it wasn't until 4 months after my arrest, at the beginning of July, that suddenly they came to me and said, pack your things, you're going out. And I was picked up by an American diplomat and taken to a villa in the Wannsee, a fine villa, and held there. And actually, we were being packaged. There were two young fellows there from Norway, because Norway had been occupied in the meanwhile. And two young fellows who actually had been working with the Norwegian underground, they didn't have enough on them to hold them. And we became a package. And on the way, we met a man named Alan, who had been picked up in occupied France. He was a freelance journalist. And the four of us were put aboard a train through Spain and to Lisbon, where we would be exchanged for the people we had been picked up for. And one bad moment was still in Germany, on the train. I got a glimpse of in the passageway walking by one of the men who had arrested me in the first place. But,
he was coming to retrieve the German and take him back.
Possibly, or to make sure that I got through to Lisbon and on the ship. Of course, Spain was half in cahoots with the Franco dictatorship, with Hitler. Portugal was a neutral country, so once you were in Portugal, you were out. And we got aboard the West Point, the liner the United States, which had been built as an ocean liner by the U.S. lines, but quickly converted to a troop transport, and came home to New York in the end of July, middle July of 1941.
Your remarkable fellow journalists who were in Germany at that time, Howard K. Smith for CBS News and William Shira, both were beginning to work on monumental books about the impending explosion of Europe. Was it generally understood by the press corps, British or others, of what was going to happen there?
Well, there was, in our office, there was absolute certainty. I think one of our American colleagues.
Neville Chamberlain and others tried suggest that there were problems.
Well, that was the year before. That was in 1938, leading up to Munich. But even in August of 1939, there were still one or two American reporters who presumably had been assured by their Nazi contacts that everything was going to be all right, who didn't think that the war was going to be on. In our office in the UP, it was an absolute dead certainty that it could only end in war, because there was no other way of getting what he wanted. That Munich was the red line that the British drew, and he had said that Czechoslovakia, the Sudetenland, was his last territorial demand. They saw that he was a liar and a violent dictator, And when from then
psychopath.
On, a psychopath, and from then on, the Brits began to sort of put their house in order. They began to dig trenches in Hyde Park, you know, and to build up, try to build up an air force. They did, the Royal Air Force, the wonderful fighter planes that they had suddenly came into production. And in August of 39, when it became clear that the crisis in Poland was with Poland was coming to a head, they tried to tell Hitler, look, don't do it, or there'll be war. He went and did it anyway on the 1st of September 1939, marched into Poland.
It may have been awkward for you, but if you'd killed Hitler at the Tempelhof Airport,
yeah.
20 or 30 million lives would have been saved.
Well, I didn't have the means to kill him. I would have gladly. Well, in those days, it wasn't. He didn't come across quite as the destroyer that he showed himself to be subsequently in really launching this war. There was considerable opposition in the German army in 1938 to the course that he was taking, and even into 1939. It was in 1939 that he purged.
He finally
vanquished
them.
And he got rid of all the dubious generals and the old hands, put in his own people, Nazis and the rest, and knew that the Wehrmacht was his instrument, his unquestioning instrument. And from then on, it was just, you know, one horror after another.
Before you went to Europe and started to report on the buildup of the German forces, you were here in the States covering our early efforts to develop a military resource in the South in Louisiana. Tell us about that little reported.
Well, that was
period.
when I came home, when I was expelled from Germany and came home in July 41. I went to work for the UP in Washington, and their first assignment for me was these maneuvers, the first sort of large scale maneuvers for the United States Army, which was a tiny army. I think the draft had only just come in. And they were putting together units and set up two opposing armies. Eisenhower was the G3 of the army in Louisiana. I was with the first army in Arkansas. And it was an interesting thing, rather depressing for me, because I had been with the German army up to Dunkirk and had seen what they had done in going through France and Belgium. And it was a fantastic army. John Keegan, who is one of the great military historians, mm-hmm. said it's the finest army of modern times. We had to beat it. And what we saw in Arkansas and Louisiana, there were one or two funny tanks, these Sherman tanks that are sort of three-story tanks. I couldn't believe my eyes, you know, because the first thing that they'd come over the right would be shot up. What you needed was low-lying, hugging armor. And they had some artillery there. They had laundry trucks sort of painted up to be some, you know, military vehicles. And the GIs wandered around. They didn't have proper weapons. And I wondered to myself, my God, you know, the war is bound to come. How will these kids fare? How will this army fare? And as it happened, after Pearl Harbor, immediately after Pearl Harbor in December 41, went to the U.S. Information Agency to do propaganda broadcasts to Germany, and went to London for them and saw in London what was going to happen. This ragtag bunch that I had seen chasing around the wilds of southern Arkansas was beginning to come to Britain as a fairly well-trained and motivated army. And the buildup in those first years, from 1942 to 1944, was phenomenal. The joke in Britain was, we were going to sink. There were so many Americans coming. And not just the army, but the Air Force. The Air Force was magnificent. And I went up not on any bombing missions with the B-17s, but flying up through cloud, you know, 25,000 feet of cloud over Britain, and these kids absolutely knowing what they were doing. I later went on bombing missions with the medium bombers, the B-26s.
Over Germany?
Over France,
over France.
Occupied France. These were medium bombers, the called flying prostitutes because they had no visible means of support. They had short, stubby wings and a very heavy wing load. And taking off was always a drama, loaded with bombs. And I went up with did the first first wire recording of a bombing mission, and I was loaded on with various a great number of automobile batteries, because the aircraft didn't have enough power to feed my wire recorder, and we went. I must have been a mile before we got off the ground, but the point is, these kids that I had seen in Arkansas and Louisiana turned up in the Air Force and on the ground as fighting machines, absolutely, unflappable. And you'd see them lolling around the sort of the Rainbow Center, the USO Center in the middle of London, slack-jawed and, leaning on the buildings and wondering what to do. When they got into their jobs, they were magnificent. And it was with them that I flew on D-Day to bomb the German positions at Utah Beach, which is just a bit west of Omaha.
Share with us what it felt like to be in a plane that was bombed and shrapnel and God knows what else around.
Well, we hit the beach at just about H hour, just a minute or two before H hour. And by then, the shell fire from the Navy offshore, and the preceding waves of bombers had softened up the defenses at Utah, and Utah, thank God, was a piece of cake for the troops that landed there. It was Omaha next door, that was the meat grinder. It was that of course is where now that wonderful cemetery is laid. Just on the ridge above that the men of the 1st Division climbed up to take. But flying in, passing over this armada of ships was an incredible sight. Firing away, but more ships coming in, troop carriers coming in. And we flew down, the optimum altitude for the B-26 was 13,000 feet. We came in at, I think, it's about 5,000 feet because the cloud was low and we had to come in under the cloud. And so we were subject to small arms fire. I mean, not just big anti-aircraft stuff. And so much so that we took off our flak jackets and put them on the floor of the plane so that the bullets coming up wouldn't get us. But we had no trouble. We had no trouble. There was no German air. The Luftwaffe had been cleaned out by the Air Force. The Air Force is the mm-hmm. Royal Air Force and the American 8th and 9th.
You mentioned a minute ago that you had followed the German army in its path west up to Dunkirk. How was the press handled that at that time?
We were a small group of, we carefully handled. There was
right.
no, it wasn't like the First Army that I joined later on. No, we were invited by the propaganda ministry and the Foreign Office. I was with a group of, I think we were four American reporters. And we were just taken, it was great propaganda for them because we just followed the road of success and what success it was. French tanks lying in the ditches on the side of the road, and the German bridges crossing the Meuse River, and the prisoner of war camps that we saw in northern France, large numbers of British soldiers who had been just gobbled up by the German advance. We went to a port in northwest France.
Were you allowed to talk to any of the captive soldiers
at
the time?
Yes, we were. And they said, what are we doing? They were shell-shocked. And, what were we doing here? The French had collapsed underneath them. And so they were disillusioned and bitter about what had happened to them.
But the British soldiers
were. British soldiers,
right.
Yeah. But we then went on to this port near the Calais, and saw how the Brits had just fled aboard ships, leaving everything behind. I mean, it was just the classic case of defeat and rout. And of course, the Germans and were the victorious army. And we went to the outskirts of Dunkirk. The fires were still burning. The Germans had penetrated and were beginning to encapsulate Dunkirk. And for some reason, I've never heard of a satisfactory explanation, Hitler ordered them not to push into the troops that were the British troops that were waiting to be evacuated at Dunkirk.
Where it would have been.
He could have done it.
Where it would have been easy to slaughter them all.
Absolutely, absolutely. Take them all prisoner.
Yeah.
But he held off, and this fabulous boat lift began, sort of pleasure cruisers and motor boats and everything, rowboats. To pick them up. And
none of the great historians to this day know why Hitler ordered that order, why Hitler made that order.
No.
I'm very grateful. Thanks again, Dick. It's been a great honor to have you with us.
Thank you, Steve.